church fails to separate the believer from the unbeliever. How God deals with us is, arise, shine, for thy light has come. I'll give you another example.
When you incorporate legalism and law into the message of the gospel of grace, and you try to mix the two, now you have a combination for disaster.
We can no longer fall under the sin of unbelief because we believe.
Right.
That's what it means, okay? So when it says you can't sin, it means you can't be an unbeliever if you're a believer. But if you are sinning, it's because your father's a devil. You've never been regenerated.
That's why we constantly put the emphasis on the new covenant. We put the emphasis on Jesus being the final author of our salvation in the complete work. There was nothing undone. We can't add or take away anything that he himself established, you know?
Yeah, I'll give you the perfect example, Pastor Bill. People are focused on the wrong thing, okay? And here's what I mean by that. They're not focused on Jesus. I'll give you an example. A professor of ours that's now with the Lord wrote a book, and it was for the first time my eyes were open. I taught the book of Revelation for 3 years on an accredited college level when I was at First Assembly. You got credit for that course. I taught it. So I knew the book of Revelation pretty good. I studied it hard. You know, the things that were, the things that are, the things that must shortly come back to pass, threefold division. But here's what I missed and everybody else misses. Here's what he said. Go read again. It's the book of the revelation of Jesus Christ, not the Antichrist.
Right.
So watch the contrast. In Isaiah 60, he says, arise and shine, for your light has come. The glory of the Lord is risen on you. And then he's talking to the world. But darkness shall cover the face of the deep. You see, great, gross darkness. Okay. And so the church fails to separate the believer from the unbeliever. How God deals with us is, arise, shine, for thy light has come. I'll give you another example. If you look at in the day of Pentecost, in the last days, and we're in the last days of the last days. The last days begin at Pentecost. We're 2,000 years later, and we believe the church age is 2,000. So we're in the last days of the last days. Read Acts chapter 2. Go back and see where he's quoting out of the book of Joel, chapter 2, verse 24. You know what it's saying? In the last days, I'm going to pour out my spirit on all flesh. All flesh.
Right.
Your sons and your daughters are going to prophesy. Your young men are going to see visions. Your old men's going to dream dreams. Listen to what it says. It says, and your vats will overflow. Your floors will be filled with corn and you will have wine. It's not this drudgery of, oh, my God, the Antichrist is coming. You know, I have friends. I had to quit fellowshipping with them because all they wanted to talk about is the Antichrist and the Antichrist is coming, the mark of the beast. And I get it. If that puts fear on you and Jude says some save by fear, hating their garments spotted, others by compassion, I'd rather use the compassionate Jesus,
right,
than just trying to put fear on people. But the point is that everybody is fearful of this. And listen to this, Pastor Bill, we talked about it. A lot of people about the virus that we had, the pandemic. Listen, 500 million people had the Spanish flu. 100 million people died. In 1918, in the United States, we were forced to be quarantined and wear masks under the threat of being arrested. This has gone on. If, Pastor Bill, if people would have been born at the time of Hitler, when we had a world war, Europe was threatened. He's a black-headed, black mustache, Aryan nation wanting a pure race of blonde-headed and blue-eyed men. You can't make that up. Hated the Jews, killed 6 million of them. Now, we know that that's what caused the Jews to come back to their homeland, which is prophesied in Ezekiel 38, that they would come back to their own land. And God used it. But I'm telling you, if you and I was living at that time And there was a war going on with Germany, and it looked like the world was going to be taken over by the Germans, and they hated the Jews, and there was an Aryan nation swastika. We would have thought the coming of the Lord was then, but it's all the beginning. But right. We should be focused on evangelism.
Yeah, and then you got to take into account also, we had the Pacific War that was going on, that we got bombed by Japan on December 7th.
Right there.
And so we had two wars that we were fighting at that time. I'm sure if you go back in history, and if there was any record of messages that were preached and what they were declaring at that time, is that the end is here. And so, you know, the thing is that I believe we're getting closer to the end. I believe it's we're sooner than later as far as Jesus coming back.
I agree with that 100%.
And I'm looking forward to that day. And if I'm there to witness it, hallelujah, I'll be caught up with him. He'll come and take his bride away. But that's a whole nother subject. But right now, I think that personally, my heart is to see people get liberated like you and I got set free. We came out of a very, very rigid, stringent background of teaching and theology that actually put us in a bondage. And we labored under that, trying to be perfect, trying to be good all the time. And look, I know if you're out there and if you have a desire to serve the Lord and you're under that kind of influence in your life, then you are laboring just like we once did. Right now, I'm free because the truth has set me free. And whom the Son sets free is free indeed. And by opening up our eyes and our understanding, as Paul writes about in Ephesians, that's what took place in our lives. And when that happened, there was no going back to what we were once ensnared and entangled with. The letter of the law kills. I say this all the time, that a lot of believers, most believers that don't understand the finished work of the cross and don't understand what Jesus accomplished through his death, burial, and resurrection, and the new covenant and the new commandments and all that's associated with that event, I believe that they're dying a slow death, because the letter of the law, it kills. When you incorporate legalism and law into the message of the gospel of grace and you try to mix the two, now you have a combination for disaster. And here's how the disaster plays itself out in most cases. People try to be perfect. They try to be good. They try to own up to the standards and the regulations and all of the demands that this type of teaching places on people. And I'm going to let you know right now, every one of us, including myself, all of us are going to fail miserably of trying to obtain that type of perfection. And Jesus knew that. And that's why he came and he was perfect in all of his ways, fulfilled the law, and moved us out from underneath it, because he knew within ourselves we could never, ever reach that standard and live according to those demands. You're laboring under that legalism and that type of message. And here's what happens. It diminishes your love for the Father, because now everything is conditional. If my relationship with my wife and I was based on me being a certain way and her being a certain way, and we upheld and we placed those standards and conditions that were high and lofty, and we failed miserably, guess what? Our relationship would be diminished to the point probably where it would get to the point where we wouldn't even want to be around one another. And if we were around one another, it wouldn't be the most pleasant experience, because I would always feel like I was doing something wrong and she would always feel that she was doing something wrong. And that's the relationship you get when you have a religious, legalistic message that's coming and derived from old covenant, transferred into the new covenant, and trying to make the two one. It don't mix. He said, get rid of the bondwoman. That was an act of the flesh, man trying to be made
righteous.
And her
children.
Yeah.
And her children.
And
have
her
nothing
children.
To do with them.
Exactly. They're incompatible, Pastor.
No.
They were incompatible.
He goes on to say, even to this day, those that are of the flesh persecute us that are of the Spirit.
That's right.
See, and then the next verse says, therefore, stand fast, therefore, in your liberty, wherewith Christ has set you free.
Amen.
Now, Pastor Bill, I want to just mention, because I want to dissect Romans 7 down the road. I don't want to do it now, but I want to refer to it. One of the biggest things that threw me off, okay, as a believer, that didn't allow me to see what I can see today. In Bible college, I thought the Judaizers, and it means this, that they were trying to Judaize the Gentile. They were trying to bring Judaism and all of what they were doing under the law and making the Gentiles do it. And Paul rejected that out of Galatians chapter 2. Yes. When he wrote the book of Galatians, he set all of that straight.
Correct.
And so what happens is in the case of this idea that Paul was trying to distinguish to you and I in Romans chapter 7 was that he lays out exactly how he was miserable under the law. We were taught, okay, that was him as a believer. Why? Because as a believer, we still fall short of the glory of God. That's not the definition of 1 John 3:4, sin is the transgression of the law. Where there is no law, when God satisfied the law to us, we can no longer fall under the sin of unbelief because we believe.
Right.
That's what it means, okay? So when it says you can't sin, it means you can't be an unbeliever if you're a believer. But if you are sinning, it's because your father's the devil. You've never been regenerated, and you're still accountable to the law. So when you go down Romans 7, and Paul starts saying, finally, now I'll prove to you Romans 7 is not the saved man. Hey, the Holy Spirit will convict you. We talked about this. Whom the Father loves, he corrects. The body of Christ isn't judged. Right. He already judged us, found us not guilty. We're in the flesh, we're out of the flesh, we're in the spirit, one minute.
Because we're doing everything right, and we're honoring God and we're not breaking his word.
Now you see the self-righteousness in that? I mean, the self-righteousness is evident. The law cannot save you. The law can't change you. And yet they keep going back to it like that's the magic, if I could just keep all of them.
Yeah.
And that was the Pharisees' problem.